Welcome back, everyone. It is great to be with you again as we continue our study in the book of Ecclesiastes. I want to start by asking you a question. A little trivia here for you. See if you know this. What song holds the distinction of being the number one hit on the U.S. Billboard charts with the oldest lyrics? Thinking back through all the years of Billboard charts, do you have any idea? Well, some of you might know it's the song Turn, Turn, Turn by Pete Seeger. The song itself was first written in the late 1950s, but the lyrics are much, much older. Maybe you have remembered that song. The lyrics are actually the poem that are the passage that we're going to be studying today in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. So you can turn there if you would like to. But instead of me reading this passage to you, at least the first 8 verses, I'd like you to listen to the song. Over the years, there have been many renditions of Pete Seeger's song, and perhaps the most famous version is the cover of it by The Byrds. It hit number one on the charts in December 1965. So follow along with The Byrds as they sing verses 1-8 for us.
I swear it's not too late.
Isn't it fascinating that a poem that is at least 2,500 years old still sounds so relevant to our lives? Now, one line of the poem kind of gives us a clue that this is a very ancient piece of literature from a different time. So before we talk about how relatable the poem is, look with me at verse 5. It says, "There is a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them." Now, can you think of any times or reasons in our day and age that gathering and scattering stones would be important enough to make it into a list like this, of verses 1 through 8, of all these really important human activities? Working with stones, that's a really specific kind of activity. Not that many people work with stones in our day and age. I mean, think about it. Who does? Maybe the masons, builders, some artists work with stones. But if you imagine ancient culture, well, actually, if you're here in Lancaster County like I am, given our heritage, you might actually not have to imagine too hard about what ancient culture was like when it comes to gathering and scattering stones, because it used to be a common activity and one that still happens in many farms, like we have many of them in Lancaster County today. The clearing of fields. Stones, over the course of a year's time, will come to the surface or be revealed by rains. And so farmers have to go around and remove stones from their fields, sometimes every year, depending on how stony that particular soil is. How many of you maybe even have worked on farms and you've had to participate in removing them, maybe walking through a field with a wagon and pick up the stones and throw them on the wagon? Because when a farmer grows crops, they do not want stones in their fields. Now, stones, of course, are also gathered for things like building walls and houses, and fireplaces, chimneys, walkways. And that is still true today. But it was incredibly commonplace in the ancient world. Stones were used as ammunition in warfare. Slingers threw stones. They formed an ancient artillery that was deadly force. Remember the story? David and Goliath, for example. David was a gatherer of stones. Stones were also used in the punishment of stoning. It was an ancient form of the death penalty. So even though most of us in the 20th and 21st century now probably have spent very little time in our lives gathering stones, we can see how it was a task that was really important, commonplace in the ancient world. But what about the second half of that verse? Not just the time to gather stones, what about scattering stones? I mean, actually, some of us might have done some scattering of stones. When I read this, the first thing that came to my mind was the practice of being on the side of a lake or a stream, up some flat stones to try and skip them across the water, see how many times you could get them to skip. Or maybe if you were there along a bit of a lake that had started freezing over in the winter, you'd find a big, huge rock and throw it under the ice and try and break up the ice and make a splash. But other than that kind of fun stuff, I don't know why too many people in our day and age would scatter stones, or in the ancient world either. So thinking about that one part of verse 5, it seems to me that the rest of these 13 couplets that are in these verses are very relatable to our lives, even in 2020. The poem, as we heard, brings up so many central themes to humanity: the cycle of life, relationships, work, emotions. I mean, this is the stuff of life that we give most of our time to. It's the stuff that we care about deeply. The poem, therefore, becomes another reflection, such as we've seen in the previous chapters in Ecclesiastes, on the cyclical, fleeting nature of life. The teacher's been talking about this from the very beginning. But with this poem, the teacher seems to be using opposites to illustrate that cyclical, fleeting pattern in life. There are 14 sets of opposites in these verses. Now, 4 years ago, our family experienced this pattern of opposites really vividly. Some of you know that our daughter, Megan, used to have a floppy-eared rabbit named Bun Bun. We kept that rabbit in a rabbit hutch right outside on our side deck. And every day before school, Meg would go out there to talk to Bun. one bun, peek in on her, say hi, good morning, and so on. There really was not much work involved in taking care of this bunny. You would just have to feed her, fill up her water bottle, clean out her hutch every now and then. You'd give her that shredded paper or maybe some sawdust so that she could burrow in and stay warm on cold nights. Now, the only exception to that is when the temperature dropped below freezing. Then, really, to be safe, we would pick up the entire hutch and pull it into our laundry room so that she could make it through those cold, cold nights. Here's the thing, though. That thing was heavy and hard to pick up, and it just barely fit into our laundry room. And really, depending on how long it had been since we cleaned it out, it would stink. So, even though we'd done this for 3 years, there was one night that third year where we looked at the weather report and it was going to be around 30 degrees or so. We thought to ourselves, I think Bun Bun's going to be fine. So the next morning, Meg woke up. She went out to see Bun Bun as normal and came right back in the house screaming. She said, Bun Bun's not moving. I thought, oh no, it can't be. Well, to use the words of verse 2, it was a time to die. Bun Bun was frozen stiff. We felt awful. Meg was a mess. And for Meg, to use the words of verse 4, it was a time to mourn. Now, soon enough, the sadness passed, and Meg got a new idea. She was interested in a guinea pig. We had previously had a hamster, and that thing just spent so much time running on its wheel and just stinking up our house that I really wasn't too keen on the idea of a guinea pig. I didn't ever grow up with pets, and quite frankly, I am totally fine without them. For me, I should have followed the words of verse 7, which says, a time to be silent. But for whatever reason, I decided that it was a time to speak. As Meg was asking for a guinea pig, I opened my mouth and said, you know what, Meg? I would rather have a dog than a guinea pig. Well, all of a sudden, for Meg, it was now verse 4, a time for laughing and dancing. I think it was also a time for verse 5. There was probably some embracing going on as I got some hugs out of that statement. I don't know what got into me, if I'm honest. And I couldn't take back my words at that point, though. And that launched Michelle and Meg into a season of verse 6, a time for searching. They visited the Humane League, and they visited the ASPCA, and they went to all kinds of websites online, searching and searching and searching for just the right dog. And after looking and looking and looking, they finally found Bentley. Though it's not precisely the words of verse 2, it was now a time to be born, because we adopted Bentley at 2 years old, and essentially he was born anew into our family. And very quickly then, it was time for verse 8, a time to love. But not for me. Like I said, I didn't grow up in a pet family. We would have pets from time to time, but it never lasted long. It just didn't fit with my family. So to have this animal walking around our house, and not a small little hamster or bunny, but a dog, it's about a medium-sized 65-pound dog, needing to go outside all the time, barking super loud whenever people come in our driveway. I was probably more, if you go down there to verse 8 again, more like a time to hate. I know that's a strong word, and so maybe it wasn't quite like that, but you know the crazy part about this thing? From the moment I walked into the house that day that they brought Meg home, they brought him home, brought Bentley home, they brought him home before me, it was like Bentley decided that I was his person. He would follow me around everywhere. I go to the bathroom and he lays outside the bathroom door. I was not a fan of all of this following. But in a couple weeks, I decided, all right, Bentley, let's see how you'll do on a run. And I took him out for a run because I like to go running. That was the beginning of something new. In the nearly 4 years now that we've had Bentley, he has gone on runs with me a lot. In fact, this past summer, just a month ago or so, he went with me on a 9-mile run. It was the farthest he's ever been. Many of you actually have seen us running out on the roads nearby. And I can honestly say, he has grown on me. Back to verse 8, I can say that I have had a transformed heart. It is a time to love. It's so interesting how people and animals can grow on you. From hate to love. Life is so often a study in opposites like that, isn't it? Put another way, life is about extremes. So what the teacher is describing for us here is really not a surprise. We know this. We instinctively know it to be true because this description of a life of extremes is our daily human experience. In other words, the teacher is saying we should not be surprised at life's extremes. C.S. Lewis talks about this in his book, The Screwtape Letters, and he calls it the law of undulation. Undulation is just simply a fancy word that describes how waves go up and they go down and they go up and they go down. Whether we're talking about waves at the beach or maybe electromagnetic waves or microwaves or light waves, radio waves, you name it, they go up and they go down. And they have crests and they have troughs. The crests are the peaks and the troughs are the low points. So the law of undulation states that a high point will follow a low point. And after that, another high point will arrive, and after that, another low point will arrive over and over and over, just like the waves on the seashore. Now, of course, life isn't precisely like that because we often use the phrase, when it rains, it pours, right? Talk about how sometimes we get three or four low points in a row, or we get a number of high points in a row. I wonder how history will remember 2020. And yet, the law of undulation remains basically true because inevitably that bad streak will end. Something good will happen. And we can expect it. I mean, really, this goes both ways. After a season of blessing, we might have a tragedy. It's not a guarantee by any means, but we can expect it. In fact, Lewis says we should expect it so that we're not rocked by it, not thrown off kilter as if the tragedy that just happened was somehow this impossible thing that happened. That's not what life is like. That's one way that we can learn from the teacher's poem. Do not be surprised at the ups and downs of life. If you instead can embrace the fact that life is cyclical and fleeting, you'll be much, much more prepared to handle whenever the good comes and the bad comes. Christians, I have seen in my own life as well, really can be confounded by this tendency when we have an amazing spiritual experience. Could be a youth retreat, a camp meeting, a men's retreat, a mission trip, something like that, maybe even a particular worship service. It can also come true in a non-spiritual sense on a really great vacation. On those special events, we give this experience something that we call a high. It's a feeling of deep emotional joy and excitement. Love it. We're riding the crest of the wave. Now, maybe we experienced great musical worship. Maybe it was a speaker who we enjoyed so much. Maybe we just had more alone time with God, or maybe our eyes were open to a new culture halfway around the world, and it impacted us so deeply. Maybe we felt great because we had this experience of serving sacrificially. There are so many ways that we can experience the wonder of the mountaintop. And then we come back home. Now, we're still very excited, even though we've come back home. But boy, can that change quickly. We go back to work. We go back to school. Back to the chores of dishes and laundry and the car breaking down. And what happens? We can quickly crash into a serious disappointment. We can start to call into question the validity of this high that we experienced. Maybe that mountaintop experience was false. Sure didn't seem false at the time, but why is it gone so quickly? Shouldn't a genuine spiritual experience last longer than that? And so we hunger for another. And we seek another high. We want a repeat. We want another hit. It's very human of us to want the good stuff. These joys, these highs, these excitements, as if that is where the truth is found. As if the mountaintop experiences are what God wants us to have all the time. Well, the teacher, in these couplets, in these opposites, reminds us of the law of undulation. highs naturally lead to lows, and that's okay. It's to be expected, actually. When we come home from the powerful retreat weekend and we are faced with struggles or just plain old boredom, the daily grind of school and chores and jobs, if we start to feel like something is wrong with us, if we start to feel like failures, if we start to feel like spiritual nobodies, we can remember that actually nothing is wrong, more than likely. Instead, it's probably just the law of undulation at work. The troughs, the low points, they will not last forever. There will be a time for joy, and there is a time for pain. Life is cyclical. So how do we respond to the law of undulation? Well, the teacher tells us, thankfully. Take a look at verses 9 and 10. I'm going to read them for you. He says, "What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on men." We're in very familiar territory here. What the teacher has to say in verses 9 and 10 is really similar to what we heard last week in chapter 2, verses 24 through 26. There, his conclusion of these seven different personalities that he tried out, trying to find the meaning of life, and he said this in verse 24, chapter 2. "A man can do nothing better than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in his work." And that's exactly where the teacher goes next. So if you peek ahead to chapter 3, verses 12 and 13, notice how similar they sound. There, he says, "I know that there is nothing better than for men to be happy and do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is the gift of God." They're almost identical, aren't they? So the teacher is clearly connecting these two passages, the end of chapter 2 and right here in the middle of chapter 3. He's developing a theme, actually. And here it is. While life is cyclical and fleeting, and we may never be able to understand God's ultimate purposes, God has given us a pathway for joy. In this, we're starting to see what my Old Testament professor Dave Dorsey said about the book of Ecclesiastes. He said it's actually gotten a bad rap. Some people think that Ecclesiastes is the most depressing book in the Bible, but he pointed out that the teacher in Ecclesiastes actually has more references to joy and happiness than you'll find in the book of Philippians in the New Testament, which is often called the Bible's book of joy. Now, of course, Ecclesiastes is a good bit longer than Philippians, but the point remains. Ecclesiastes has an incredibly joyful approach to the meaning of life. So let's take a closer look at verses 9 through 15 here in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and I think you'll see what I mean. Look at verse 9. Right after his poem, the teacher transitions with a question about the poem. What does a worker gain, he says, from all this? Now, Dorsey translates it this way, and I find this really helpful, that actually the teacher is saying, what is the ultimate significance of all these activities? Well, he's answered this question, the teacher, numerous times, so he doesn't need to answer it again. And the answer, if he were, based on everything he has already said, if he were to answer this, the answer is basically, what is the significance of all these activities? Not much, if anything at all. So in the poem, we certainly understand that there is an appropriate time and place for all these different activities, but we can't understand their ultimate significance. So in verse 10, the teacher says, this is a heavy burden God has placed on humans. Now, Dorsey's translation here is a good bit different, but I think it's helpful because the NIV that I'm reading from tends to be unnecessarily negative at this point. Notice how Dorsey translates it differently. Rather than talking about God placing a heavy burden on us, he says this, "It should be, I thought about all that God gives humans to do to occupy them." Now, like verse 9, what he says there in verse 10 is a reflection on the poem in verses 1 through 8, all those opposites. The teacher's thinking about them. But what does he think about them? He tells us in verse 11, and again, Dorsey's translation is very helpful. So let me try and set up this flow of thought, the teacher's logic here. When the teacher says in verse 10 that he thought about all that God gave humans to do to occupy them, now he goes on to say, basically, I could see that God has designed each of these activities so that it has an appropriate time to be done. We saw that in verses 1 through 8. Time to be born, time to die, time to laugh, time to mourn, and so on. But God has also placed in the human heart a sense that there is an overall greater plan for all these things. The problem is that he hasn't given human beings the ability to perceive that plan or to understand God's agenda from the beginning to the end. In other words, God has placed us in a world where there is much to do. We have a desire to know the larger picture, but ultimately we can't know it because it's only God's to know. So what do? Are we just destined to be caught in this fog of not understanding the meaning of life? Well, thankfully, there is more to the story. And that's what the teacher tells us in verses 12 through 15. They present this other view, one that I'm really thankful for. Now, a few weeks ago, I said that there was a period of about consecutive months where 8 people from Faith Church died. And it was at least 1 per month, and sometimes 2 per month. And I did every funeral, listening to and counseling those 8 grieving families. And it weighed heavy on me, and I was starting to think about death constantly, and I couldn't shake it. It really actually freaked me out. Well, I never told you what helped me begin to resolve that struggle. It was these verses, 12 through 15, and the others like them. Let me read what he says. He says, "I know there is nothing better for men than to be happy and do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in his toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that men will revere him. Whatever is has already been, and what will be has been before, and God will call the past to account." I want to ask, do you hear the joy in that? As the teacher is saying here, we can be joyful and do good during the time that we have, no matter the circumstance or the season. Rather than be upset that we can't know all of the meaning about it or all of God's purposes for it, we can be satisfied and even happy with what we don't, with what we do know. What God has given us, the life, the work, the relationships. Now, Dorsey suggests that the word happy there is not just the temporary emotion of happiness. Instead, it's a more, it's better termed to be joy, a deep, abiding joy. We can experience joy even in the midst of the fleeting life that we live, even in the difficult times. That's what really helped me when all I could think about was death, and I didn't want to die. I could take the teacher, I could take God at his word, and enjoy the life that God has given me. Now, the teacher expands on this in verse 13. We can enjoy the life that God has given us, including the basics like drinking and eating. Yes, even we can find satisfaction in our work. And the teacher says, this is the gift of God. Got me thinking, like, imagine a world where eating and drinking would be horrible, where you need to do this to survive. You have to eat. You have to drink in order to survive. But doing it, like, either tasted horrible or made you sick all the time. Now, for some people in our world, this is a reality. We need to be sensitive to that. In fact, one of our EC pastors has a son with really pervasive allergies to food, and they have struggled and struggled to keep their son healthy. But for most of us, eating is a distinct pleasure. Even in places without a variety of foods, I've noticed that people appreciate the pleasure of eating and drinking. I remember on my summer missionary internship between my junior and senior year of college, I went to Guyana, South America for 13 weeks. And right in the middle of that summer trip, we took, I was working with missionaries there and some local churches, and there was a church conference in the capital city, and I joined the churches in that. I was super excited to go to the capital city because they had KFC. I had been missing fast American fast food for the whole summer, and I was going to get some KFC. Well, you know what the Guyanese friends of mine said about KFC? They said they missed their rice. I was like, what are you talking about? because they ate rice literally, no joke, for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Bland old rice, and that's what they missed. But you know what? That's the joy that God has given us. Even the joy of eating rice. And we would do well to live joyfully that way. Instead of fixating on the shortness of life, instead of feeling freaked out by death, I learned to change my thinking to enjoy the life that God has given me. And that's hard, quite honestly, in the United States of America, because we are taught, we are bred to be dissatisfied. I was recently listening to a podcast where the speakers were talking about how our consumerism in our culture has really impacted Christians. They said that the United States of America used to be considered a place where it was super easy or the greatest place to be a Christian. But in recent years, that viewpoint is changing. One guy was talking about how he found out that people were reviewing his church on Google, and not all the reviews were favorable. People are used to going out to eat, and then when they are done with their meal, they get on Google or they get on Yelp and they post a review. My sandwich was too cold. My bacon was not crispy enough. The decor was old. You can do that for churches too. I didn't get the sermon that I wanted. Projection system wasn't bright enough. I'm only giving you a 3 out of 5 stars. Think about the mindset of that. Now, I'm not saying that churches should have a blank check to be able to do whatever they want. I'm not saying that churches should be free from any evaluation. But what I'm saying is that we need to be aware that we bring a consumer's mindset to our faith. And that can work powerfully within us to make us very dissatisfied about the many elements of our faith. And the result is it steals our joy. What the teacher is advocating for here is a view of life that trusts in God to answer the big questions of life, releasing us as humans to live simply and joyfully. And that brings great meaning to our lives. That's a life that we can enjoy and share and pursue a flourishing of humanity. As Michelle and I talked about this sermon, we both thought of the Robinson and Hershey family this past year. As we walked with them through Cheryl's diagnosis of cancer, her treatments, the ups and downs of her battle with cancer, there were certainly times of sorrow. But there was always a deep joy that came out as well. An assurance of God's goodness in the midst of the pain, in the midst of the questions and the many ups and downs of that situation. We spent time in the ER, in the hospital with them. And there were questions. Why is this happening? There was sorrow. But there was still always a deep assurance, a peace. That final week, we both spent time at their house. And there were tears. There was sorrow. There was also smiles, even times of laughter. There was deep sadness, but there was also deep comfort and joy in the Lord. And there was never a complaint from Cheryl. Philippians chapter 4, Paul talks about what we should let our minds dwell on. He says, whatever is true, whatever is good, whatever is noble, whatever is right, think on these things. That will help us to keep these different seasons in life in perspective. Where is your mind during the seasons of good as well as during the seasons of not so good? Now, it doesn't mean that we never feel sad, but instead we choose to fix our minds on God and His goodness, and His purity, His faithfulness in the midst of all the ups and downs, these normal seasons of life that so often change. When we fix our minds on who He is and the truth of who He is, that can change our minds. It can change our hearts and help us to experience joy in the midst of it all. Lord, I thank you so much for this reminder from the teacher, this ancient wisdom about how we can be joyful in the midst of the cyclical, fleeting nature of life, in the midst of these opposites that sometimes pull us and really cause us to struggle. Thank you, Lord, that there is joy in who you are, And so I pray that you would help us to fix our minds on you. We need you. We cannot do it without you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We thank you so much for being with us. And a reminder again, if you'd like to learn more about Faith Church, hear more sermons, or just learn about what we're involved in, pursuing the mission of God, please visit us at findfaithhere.org.